Hi there, God here. You know, off of the Bible and those adverts for the lottery. It could be you. It wasn't, and it never will be. Welcome to heaven. I've been rushed off my feet recently, sorting out and causing all the appalling disasters in Libya, Yemen, the Ivory Coast, Japan, New Zealand, Australia, Syria, and Bahrain. Fuck, I keep on forgetting Bahrain. Has anyone got a pen? Thanks, Elvis. Off you fuck. How am I supposed to help everyone? I mean, I can't be everywhere. Yes, I can. I'm God. That's the whole point. I'm omnipresent, you idiot.
Get on with it, me. Dick.
Sorry, me. Hey, MJ, how are you doing? Hang on, you're not even meant to be here. You're meant to be in the other place. He's off to interfere with some cherubs. Look at all these prayers. Of course, most of these will just be people that have stubbed their toes or finished having sex shouting out my name. Here's a prayer from half the people in Libya. It says, please help us defeat Gaddafi's forces of evil. Well, that sounds pretty reasonable. Accepted. Oh, and here's a prayer from the other half of the people in Libya saying, please help us defeat NATO's evil forces. That seems reasonable too. Accepted. Civil war. Civil War. Mr. Jones of Colchester, heart attack. I'm vengeful, what can I tell you? Hello? Oh, hang on. It's a polar bear. He says his iceberg is melting, please help. Yeah, well, Mr. Polar Bear, when was the last time you went to church? I tell you when, never. Fuck off. Denied. Mrs. Jenkins of Barnstable, have a big win on the bingo. And then while celebrating, choke on a chicken bone.
Swings and roundabouts, isn't it? I've got a prayer here from the Muslim half of the Ivory Coast asking for help. You need to talk to Allah. And I can pretty much guarantee you I will not be dressing up as Allah anytime soon. Oh, thanks, Marilyn. You know that song's not about you anymore. Unlucky. It's a text message. It's from Wayne Rooney. It says, dear dog. I think he means God. I've gone, done a swear, and now I'm in right trobs. Please help. P.S. Is Mother Teresa in heaven? If so, can I have her number? She is well fit.
Accepted.
Right, now I'm afraid I've got to go. I've got to be the voice in Charlie Sheen's head. Laters, potatoes.
We live in a divided society, but all of our politicians are united in pretending to mind. David Cameron and Ed Miliband are equally desperate to work alongside more people who hold their knife like a pen. But can we reach a truly meritocratic society where the brightest kids from council estates can rise to get well-paid jobs while every spoilt, listless child of the middle classes can sink to the death they deserve in a pool of their own piss? With me to discuss social mobility are Johan Hari from The Independent, Shane Greer from Total Politics, and Joe Rice from young people's charity Spear. Thank you all for coming. So, Shane, what do you think the government should be doing to enhance social mobility?
I mean, the first thing is obviously education. I mean, when you look at certain parts of the UK, Northern Ireland, for example, there, the choice isn't so much, you know, if you have money, you want to send your child to a private school. There, actually, you'll still send your child to a state school, one of the grant-maintained schools, integrated schools that provide tremendous education. But if you find yourself in part of England, for example, certainly the inner city, that choice isn't the same. Your obvious answer, if you have money, is to send your child to private school. In my mind, the question is, how do we make state education great education education across the UK. That's true for any government, because ultimately it's about standards, and we have to look and be aspirational and say, well, there is a reason why people pay oftentimes substantial amounts of money. Just think of Nick Clegg, the money his parents spent to have him go to Westminster School. There's a reason people pay that. The question is how we improve state education such that those who come from disadvantaged backgrounds can attain the highest kind of education, get the skills and move forward in the workforce, because that's the only thing ultimately that improves lives, improves standards of living, and generally raises the standard for communities and so on.
But that would take a lot more investment, wouldn't it?
There's investment. It's also about trying different things. I'll give you an example. I'm a governor at a primary school in Earlsfield, and one of the things they run there is a writing and reading program called Read, Write, Ink. And at the start of the year, there was a pupil who came in without the ability to speak English. He simply couldn't speak it. He didn't read it. He was a recent immigrant. Now he's reaching the same standards as the other children in the class because they took an individual focus. They were much more flexible. They were prepared to experiment. So it's not just about necessarily investment. It's about trying different things.
Individual tutoring for everyone, I think, would definitely work. Joe, what do you think? What do you think would people who are outside society, who don't have jobs, who maybe for generations people have been on welfare, you work with a charity with those people, what do you think the government should be doing to help them?
I think our experience of addressing the issues that young people that we work with face is the issues are around aspiration. As you say, some of them are third generation unemployed, they've never seen anyone go to work, and they have very low expectations on their own attainment, and other people have very low expectations on their attainment, and they live up to those expectations. And so one of the things we try to address is raising those expectations and placing them on them. So life skilling is a really key part of what we do. And also in understanding just the hidden rules of the working world, equipping young people with the understanding that actually saying thank you is a really big part of surviving in working life, and that's not part of their culture.
Johan, do you think that's the key, teaching people to say please and thank you? And then,
well, it's part of it, but I think Joe does fantastic work, but I think there's a much more complicated picture. The international comparisons show that Britain has one of the worst mobilities in the world. Overwhelmingly in Britain, if you're born poor, you'll die poor. If you're born rich, you'll die rich. There are societies that have changed that. Britain has actually become considerably worse. As we've become more like America, which is the most immobile country in the entire developed world, we've become more immobile.
So our social mobility has got worse.
Considerably worse over the past 30 years, right. Dramatically worse. And there's all sorts of policies you can have that affect that. The single best one is Sure Start. All the evidence we've got shows that inequality kicks in way before the kid goes to school. It's actually there the first day they turn up at the school gates. Best thing you can do is have intensive programs that work with mums, help them bond with their kids, help their kids get stimulated. The research on this is absolutely incredible. In America, they've been doing it for 40 years. The kids who went through Sure Start are 42% more likely to be in employment and 50% less likely to go to prison. It's incredible. And it's really important that people know, David, the government is shutting those programs down.
Sure Start
is closing all over Britain.
We need more investment from the government doing that kind of scheme.
I think when you look at something like that, there's no question that early intervention is key. If you grew up in, for example, let's take somewhere in Glasgow. The Guardian recently pointed out that there's one area in Glasgow where life expectancy is 54 years of age. 54
lower
years of age.
Lower than in the Gaza Strip.
Lower than Iraq and in many other much less developed
countries. The point is, at the moment, the government is cutting back on a lot of schemes that helps people like
that.
It's not just
as simple as saying we need more investment. Certainly investment is key. It's not just as simple as saying we need a one-size-fits-all solution. We don't. If you're a child growing up in the home counties versus one that's growing up in Toxteth and Liverpool or the West Winds Estate in Northern Ireland, there are very different requirements that you have. The education will need to be different to meet that. We can't have a one-size-fits-all approach. It has to be about individualism. It has to be about experimentation, trial and error. We're not going to get a perfect system overnight. That's not going to happen.
Shane, you're right,
it
but we've had
time.
Lots of experiments that we've been shown to work that are being abandoned. For example, educational maintenance allowance gives the poorest kids £30 a week to stay on at sick form. Been incredibly successful. David Cameron promised he'd keep it. He's got rid of it. That's going to have a terrible effect
on
humility.
Equally, if you look at something like academies, let's look at something like academies. We've seen under Blair when he brought those in that the attainment there is tremendous because, again, you've got a more individualistic focus. People are free to experiment.
But aren't those academies and things like that, and free schools and that sort of, aren't those? Those are essentially playing to the middle classes, because the middle classes always get the best out of both, obviously, the private education system, but also the state system, because they play that system. How do you make the education system, the state education system, fair?
We have to accept one thing, first of all. We can't fix it overnight. We're not going to have equality across the nation right now. We're not going to have the best education system immediately or even in a couple of years, but at least by branching out, at least by allowing people to start individual schools. And again, it was a great program that was started essentially under the Blair government's move until now. We get experimentation. experimentation, but we get innovation, and we raise standards as a result.
But isn't letting people set up individual schools with public money taking money away from the existing schools?
No, you're taking that individual child's allowance and putting it somewhere else, but we're getting focused on a small argument.
I'd just like to bring you in here. Joe, what would you say, because I know with your charity you involve business a lot. Is that something you would say?
Yeah, and one of the things that we've realised is businesses can play a fantastic role in working with the young people that we work with. So businesses who are encouraged to give an opportunity to a young person who otherwise wouldn't have it.
Well, the government should be there encouraging, should they? Should
I
be
think
providing
it'd be fantastic
grants?
To incentivise businesses to do it, but actually I'm not sure the government needs to incentivise it. I think businesses are keen.
Well, what needs to happen then? Because something's not working.
Well, the businesses that we're approaching who are saying, and we're saying, look, we will equip young people with the basic life skills that you can start from, and we will support you in working with that young person. They're taking this on, and we're seeing some fantastic results with young people working in environments they would never get an opportunity to work in otherwise.
And you asked about the motivation of the current government. I think there's a couple of quotes that really illustrate this. I want to just read one out because I want people to understand this is a genuine quote. This is not a joke. It's from Dylan Jones's book of interviews with David Cameron. David Cameron's talking about his wife, who's the daughter of a baronet, no fault of her own, grew up on an estate with 300 acres. So what he said about her. The papers keep saying that Samantha is from a very blue-blooded and privileged background, but that's not true at all. She's highly unconventional. She went to a day school.
Well,
David Cameron's vision of the class system. The idea we're going to get more mobility from this guy is bonkers.
Well, you are quite right. He does seem quite posh. Unfortunately, we have to leave it there. Lauren.
God knows. We've all done something embarrassing in our time. For example, I still can't show my face in the Dagenham branch of Toys R Us. Geoffrey the giraffe. Long fucking memory. But if you can afford it, the law can shield your name. How? Get yourself a super injunction. In the last 2 years, at least 30 of these gossip-squashing super injunctions have been granted to celebrities, sportsmen and financiers, like famous banker Fred Goodwin. Touchy Fred has taken out a super injunction to stop people referring to the former European Banker of the Year as a banker. How could we talk about it? Well, Fred's super injunction only came to light after an MP used his special parliamentary superpowers to mention the super injunction in a debate. Confused? Me too. Listen, let me try and break it down. Let me explain how the super injunction shit works. Let's imagine that David knows a secret about me. Say that I'm having an affair with Jimmy. Rock on. You'd like to tell someone about it, David, wouldn't you? But you can't. You see, I've taken out an injunction against you, which stops you from telling anyone what Jimmy and I have been up to. Take that free speech kablam! Now, Charlie, you might not know that Jimmy and I have been doing the bad naughty, but you do know that I've taken out an injunction about something, and you'd like to tell your friend Anton Dubek about it. Well, you can't. You see, the thing is, I've taken out a super injunction, which not only stops you talking about my affair with Jimmy, if you knew about it, which you don't, so you can't. I'm not even going to look. It also prevents you talking about the very fact that I have an injunction out against David. Follow me? No? Good. Now, David, I know that you know that to get round my super injunction, all you need to do is get your MP to bring it up in Parliament. Remember, they've got special powers. Don't even think about it, egghead. You see, I've taken advantage of a new bit of free speech-crushing judicial innovation. I'd only gone and bought myself a bloody hyper-injunction. These actually exist. Hyper-injunctions exist. They are so powerful that you can't even talk to your MP or a lawyer about it. And so my affair with Jimmy remains a sordid, yet beautiful, secret. If only I hadn't just talked about it on national telly. Facepalm. Charlie.